Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to the House Republican Conference Annual Issues Conference Retreat in White Sulphur Springs, West Virginia, which is proudly represented by Congresswoman Carol Miller, who will be welcoming all the House Republicans here today. This is an opportunity for House Republican members to continue our planning and work for our legislative agenda for the House Republican majority, especially as we head into a historic November election. This is a working retreat where we will hear updated polling presentations. We will be hosting special guests like Israeli Ambassador Herzog and members' discussions on economic, pro-family, and national defense policies. No matter where you go across the country, whether it's in upstate New York in my district, or in West Virginia right here, it is clear that hardworking American families are struggling due to the crisis Joe Biden's failed policies have created. The Biden border crisis hurting small businesses, farms, and hardworking families, and our precious allies like Israel are under attack. These failed far-left policies of Joe Biden are in clear contrast to Republicans' commitment to America. Republicans are proudly the party of hardworking Americans, law enforcement, veterans, small businesses, farmers, families, seniors, and we are proudly the party of parents. It's why you're seeing President Trump and Republicans across the country gain record support from working class voters as well as Black and Latino voters. We are in the midst of a historic opportunity to save America, to save the American dream, because the American people are fed up with the extreme Democrat far left agenda led by Joe Biden that is responsible for skyrocketing Bidenflation, the Biden border catastrophe, surging violent crime, and a world in chaos. The American people are ready for strong America First leadership by President Trump in the White House, a Republican Senate, and a strong Republican majority as we pick up seats this November in the House. And to discuss further is our chair of the NRCC, who is doing an incredible job recruiting strong candidates to go on offense to grow our House Republican majority. That's my friend Richard Hudson from North Carolina. Richard.
Thank you. Well, thank you so much. Republicans in 2024 are going to grow our majority. We've got one of the best political environments we've seen in decades because President Joe Biden and the Democrats have failed. If you look at the polling, Biden's at 39% favorable, 56% unfavorable. And it's because the American people have realized his policies are making them less prosperous and less safe. The issues align with the Republicans. Immigration is the number one issue across the country, with over 8 million illegals crossing the border since Biden took office. Crime, thousands of migrants in every community across this country, most recent high profile being the murder of Laken Riley. On the economy, inflation is white hot under President Biden. In February, we just saw an eight-month increase. We watched Joe Biden give an angry, divisive State of the Union address. And not only did he not get a bump that presidents traditionally get out of that historic speech, we saw his poll numbers drop. Americans are watching the sun set on the last 4 years, and they're ready for change. In November, they're going to turn the page on Joe Biden's era of failure. We're going to usher in a new dawn of leadership under President Donald Trump and a strong, large House majority. And the man who's leading us in this endeavor, who in just four servant leader style is resonating not only with his colleagues but the American people. Ladies and gentlemen, our leader, Speaker Mike Johnson.
Thank you. Thanks, thanks, Elise and Richard, and welcome to our Issues Conference. You're so blessed that we're looking into the sun and you're not. It's right in our faces, so I'm squinting here. It is really, really bright. But a beautiful day, and we're delighted to be here in Greenbrier. It is not far from Washington, so a good place to bring the members, get them out of the hustle and bustle of Capitol Hill, and I hope you all will enjoy a day and a half of the same. I want to thank Chairwoman Stefanik and Chairman Hudson. They're just doing an extraordinary job, and because they've done such a great job, we're in a very strong position to grow our majority because of all this hard work. Elise Stefanik has done an extraordinary job just communicating the House Republicans' priorities, and these are their priorities also of the American people. Let me give you one example. On the immigration and border, Most of the polling, most recently one I looked at, it was Gallup, has it as the number one issue for the American people. We believe a big part of that is because the House Republicans have been so consistent in highlighting what is an absolute catastrophe on the border that's created by this administration. A large number of the American people, according to the polling, also recognize that the president has the executive authority to make changes there immediately, but he is unwilling or unable to do it. Politically unable, that is. Legally, he is. Chairman Hudson, along the way, has done an extraordinary job recruiting candidates and building strong campaigns at the NRCC. It's one of the greatest efforts we've seen, and there have been extraordinary results from that as well. Americans are fed up with Biden and the extreme Democrats' open borders, high cost of living, and America Last agenda. And it really is extreme. The positions they've taken are sometimes surprising even to us. One example just from yesterday, 193 of our House Democrat colleagues voted against condemning Biden's open border. I think they're going to regret that in the election cycle because I think the American people are dialed in on this. And last week's very divisive State of the Union and after Super Tuesday, when you combine all these things and the way the American people are processing all this, I believe that we are more confident than ever that we're going to grow this majority. Now in place to pick up 4 seats in North Carolina. After redistricting, a lot of people thought the Republicans would be behind, but it's actually been a wash overall. If you look at all of them and how that all settled out around the country, we will actually be about even as where we were. But we'll pick up 4 seats in North Carolina. We believe we can pick up seats in California and Texas and other places. President Biden also on Super Tuesday became the first incumbent to lose a primary since Jimmy Carter in 1980. Personally, I've been doing my part. We're all doing our part. The Speaker's responsibilities is a big one. It's a big burden. I've been working nonstop to build on this. I've traveled to nearly 20 states in the less than 4 months that I've been on the road as Speaker. This week, we transferred $3.5 million to the NRCC. That makes $7 million so far this quarter alone, and I think it's over $10 million since I became Speaker. You know, the Speaker also raises for a super PAC. Ours is CLF, and there's been tens of millions of additional dollars there. All that's publicly reported. We just do our job, and we invest as good stewards, and we're able to tell donors around the country that we will use those investments wisely, and I think they understand that. The GOP majority is the only firewall right now stopping President Biden and Chuck Schumer, and we have to grow the majority. As you all know, we have a record small majority. It's the second smallest in U.S. history with a 2-vote majority. It will soon shrink once more when Ken Buck leaves after next week. But in spite of all that, we are very, very optimistic. And there's a couple of reasons for that, and I won't go on all afternoon, but I will tell you that the environment for our side is very, very strong. 73% of Americans believe that we are going in the wrong direction. Axios reported today, here's a little excerpt, quote, new data shows that Democrats' longtime advantage with Black, Latino, and Asian American voters has shrunk to its lowest point in more than 60 years, creating a massive vulnerability for President Biden and congressional Democrats. That's what we're seeing around the country. No matter where we go, whether I'm out west in the Midwest, I mean, Long Island, the East Coast, and the Deep South, it's all the same. We're seeing an energy in the base. We're seeing a real zeal for this election. I think the enthusiasm gap is very wide and very much in our favor. And in our battleground states, we have 37 seats that we're targeting, including 5 seats that President Trump won in the last election that are held by Democrats, and including 6 open seats. And again, with redistricting, we're very well positioned. So the environment's one thing. Our recruiting class has been extraordinary as well. Because of the efforts of Richard Hudson and others who've worked in leadership of NRCC, we got one of the best classes we've ever recruited. And we have veterans and women and minorities and people who are just very highly qualified, who know their districts well, who are messaging well with the right tone. They have business acumen or experience as legislators at the local state level. It's an extraordinary group of people, and they're running very, very well. And that builds on our 2020 strategy. All 15 seats that we flipped were won by either a woman, minority, or veteran. And so these are, it's an extraordinary class of people. Another reason is because of the fundraising. The NRCC had a record year at the end of last year, and so did CLF, by the way. Our Patriots, the Republican Patriots, outraised the Democrat frontliners 4 quarters in a row. and our Patriots are sitting on $500,000 cash on hand as an advantage over their opponents. I think that overall, we're very excited about the fall, and we that election can't happen soon enough. America is in a very difficult state, and what the true state of the union is decline, because we're declining in every measurable category on the world stage. Our stature there, we're declining in our economy, we're declining with the public safety and the crime crisis that's happening around the country, because we have an open border and we have lawless district attorneys and others who are not doing their jobs. I think the American people are fed up with this. They're fed up with the cost of living and all the rest, and they're going to give the Republicans a chance to answer all those great challenges. We have those answers, and we're excited to provide them. That's what our candidates are out around the country talking about, and we're looking forward to getting to the fall. So we'll have productive time here today, and I don't know, do we have time for a few questions, I guess? Is that the front row?
Thank you. Another important topic for House Republicans is oversight of the Biden administration. You saw the court hearing this week. I want to ask you, as Speaker, what role do you see a path forward for the vote on impeachment during this Congress? And what, in your mind, are the next steps?
Well, the impeachment inquiry, as let me state, as I always do, and many of you have heard me say this many times, I think it's important to preface any response by acknowledging that impeachment is probably the heaviest power that the Congress holds, that the House specifically holds under the Constitution. Next to the declaration of war, it's a heavy responsibility, and we take it very seriously, and we have. And so you've seen a very, very slow, deliberative, investigative process, and the reason we do that is because we have that responsibility under the Constitution. Chairman Comer and Chairman Jordan and Chairman Smith and the three committees of jurisdiction have been working on this, and Oversight, Judiciary, Ways and Means, have done an extraordinary job, and they have pulled a lot of evidence together. And I think it's been alarming. I think the American people have seen that. I think the Hur report and the hearing that happened a couple of days ago was an eye-opener as well. I mean, he acknowledged that the president knew that he was not to keep these confidential documents, that he revealed them, disclosed them as a private citizen when he knew that that was not something he should do. He did it to a ghostwriter who was writing his book, for which he got $8 million, I think, as an upfront signing bonus. So he had 8 million reasons to share classified information. And he had documents spread out all over his properties, his offices, next to his Corvette in the garage. I mean, it's just astounding how reckless he was with the handling of that. He willfully retained and he wrongfully disclosed classified information as a private citizen. Anyone else would be indicted for it, but he has not been. Noticeably, his predecessor, as he calls him, President Trump, has been indicted on the same thing for much lesser offenses, by the way. And so the American people see this, they see a double standard, and they want accountability, and they want answers. All that is to tell you that this inquiry, the impeachment inquiry, and the investigation that accompanies that will continue. There are still bits of information that have been requested that have not yet been turned over, and our committees will continue to do that work, and then we'll process all of that and make those decisions as they come forward. But you'll see that coming in the days. Yep, Scott, right here. Well, we live in challenging times. We live in a time of divided government. Democracy is messy. Sometimes it's very messy. This is part of that process. But I think what you've seen is that even though we live in a time of divided government, and even though the Republicans have quite literally almost the smallest majority in U.S. history, in an effort that some deem to be impossible, we are actually moving the ball forward and getting the job done. We are governing. We passed the first six bills, the first appropriations bills, as you know. The second batch is due by March 22nd. I believe we're going to meet that deadline. Some very deliberative work has been done. And the House, while you might describe it as chaotic, the Republican-led majority has gotten a lot of really important substantive work done. Not just all of the oversight, that's a very important constitutional responsibility for us, but passing very important and meaningful legislation. H.R. 1 was our effort to lower energy costs and return to American energy independence. H.R. 2 was, of course, now our famous border security bill that we passed that had all the elements that would solve that catastrophe and problem. Go down the list. We got just the tax package that was passed in bipartisan fashion here just a couple of weeks ago, and sent it over to the Senate. We've sent a lot of substantive legislation over, and it's been collecting dust in the Democrat majority's desks. Chuck Schumer has effectively declared some of that debt on arrival. But the House is doing its job. Everyone is standing together and moving the legislation as we need to do. And we're going to keep steady hands at the wheel. I do think when we get into the fall and as we get into the next Congress, where we'll have an even larger majority, I think you'll see some changes to the procedural rules in the House. I think common sense would lead us to those conclusions, and I think there'll be a broad agreement on all that. But in the meantime, we're going to get the job done, and we're going to keep demonstrating to the American people we can do that. Front row. Hey. The question is, if you didn't hear it, do I believe there's enough evidence to impeach the president? I'll say this. I do have a lot of experience on it. I served on impeachment defense twice when they went after President Trump on the completely meritless, totally political impeachment efforts there. I've seen what the abuse of that process looks like. To be very frank with you, very honest and transparent, because I've been so busy with all my other responsibilities, I have not been able to take the time to do the deep dive in the evidence. What has been uncovered is alarming. We know that the Biden family has collected tens of millions of dollars from foreign adversaries, including China. We know that President Biden lied, and then it was proven later that he did have interaction with Hunter Biden's business associates. He was not completely in the dark and didn't know what was going on. We know all that is certainly true. We know that that the brand that they were selling, according to Devin Archer's testimony, was the name, and that Hunter was using and trafficking upon his father's name. Now, there's a lot of things that look very corrupt to the American people, to the average American, and there's a lot of things that we believe have violated the law. Does it reach the high crimes, treason, high crimes, misdemeanor standard? Everyone will have to make that evaluation when we pull all the evidence together and when we evaluate that. But clearly, this is an unprecedented level of corruption, in my view, from any White House that we've ever seen. That, by the way, the White House and the administration have been, in our view, complicit in trying to cover a lot of this up along the way. And that's very problematic as well. So I'm not going to prejudge it. I think we're still in that process. And I know that people have gotten frustrated sometimes that it's drug on too long. But hey, in our constitutional system, this is the way it's supposed to work. This is how it's supposed to look, not what the Democrats did against Donald Trump with their snap impeachments where they reached conclusions before they began their so-called investigations. We're doing the opposite, and that's why it's drug out as it has. Yeah. Well, in terms of the rules of the House, some of the norms, a lot of us long for normal Congress again, right? What does that look like? Some of us have lost sight of that. There's been a lot of traditions that have been modified here in recent days in this Congress. There's on both sides. This is just Republicans. It's the entire House that parties have engaged in. And I think that there's a desire on behalf of the vast majority of the members of the House to reestablish some of the norms with regard to rules on the floor and how legislation is handled. Many of us, you know, do long for thoughtful and deliberative conversation, even across the aisle. I think that we are beyond the days of large supermajorities on either side because of gerrymandering and the way redistricting has been done and handled around the country. I don't think it is likely that we're going to see 30 or 40 seat majorities for one party or the other for some time. And so because of that, I believe we're going to grow our House majority. I think it'll be sizable. But I do think that there's going to be a necessity for us to have a dialogue, a thoughtful discussion with members on the other side of the aisle. What a concept that we have to govern and we have to treat one another with dignity and respect as we go through and respect the institution as well. That's the kind of things I'm talking about. Nothing specific, but the motion to vacate is something that comes up a lot amongst members in discussion, and I expect there will probably be a change to that as well. But just so you know, I've never advocated for that. I'm not one who's making it an issue because I don't think it is one for now. I just think it's something that a lot of members on both sides of the aisle talk about openly, that they have a desire for more normal process on the House floor again. So we'll be looking at that on the House rules package and in our respective caucus and conference packages as well as going to the new Congress. And that's just something we should do in due course to be good stewards of the institution. So again, thank you all for being here. It'll be a good day and a half or two. And we hope you enjoy the weather and the facilities. God bless.